welcome to Rain Air View. My name is Michelle, and we're so glad you're joining us. Everyone wants to be successful in life, and there are also a lot of opinions on what success is. As we continue in our series, Good News for Everyone, we'll address the question, what does it mean to be successful? Here's Pastor Mike.
Hey there, I'm Mike, and thanks for joining me at the theater today. Recently, I got to go to the movies in an actual theater for the first time in over a year, and it was amazing. It's everything that I hoped and dreamed it would be after a year of not watching any movies in the theater. And there's something about watching a big action film on a big screen in a theater. You can't reproduce it at home, and it doesn't matter how big your television is. It doesn't matter how good your sound system is. It's just not gonna match up to what you get in a theater. Now, one of the movies that I'm really excited for this year, well, that's to say if it actually gets released this year. At the rate we're going, it may not be released until the year 2035, but I cannot wait for the seventh installment of the Mission Impossible series. Now, if you're not familiar with that series, they've been making the movies for a while now, but it's a series and it stars Tom Cruise as the unflappable Ethan Hunt, who is one of the leaders of the IMF, or the Impossible Mission Force. And as their name would suggest, their job is to do, well, the impossible. And in every movie, there's a scene that happens pretty close to the beginning, and it looks a little something like this.
Your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to penetrate the highly secured archive inside the Kremlin and retrieve Cobalt's file before he can destroy it. New intel suggests Cobalt is already en route, leaving you
4 hours, 52 minutes
to infiltrate. To save time, we've chosen your team for you. Agents Carter and Dunn. As always, should you or any member of your team be caught or killed, the Secretary will disavow any knowledge of your actions. This message will self-destruct in 5 seconds. Good luck, Ethan.
Your mission, should you choose to accept it. Every single movie it happens, and not surprisingly, in every movie, the Impossible Mission Force chooses to accept the mission. Because what happens if they don't? Well, the movie's really short and nobody's gonna wanna watch it. So every movie, they have to accept this mission, and without fail, Ethan Hunt is gonna see his mission through to the very end. Without a doubt, he is going to risk his life in the process each and every time. Why? Because success is critical. If he's not successful, the world as we know it will end. But that's the life of a secret agent. You know, for the vast majority of us, success is not defined as thwarting terrorists or defusing a nuclear bomb. But I think we all have to answer the question, how do I define success? How do you define success? And each person may define it a little bit differently. You know, for you, maybe success is, let's say it's making enough money to support the kind of lifestyle that you want to have. Or let's say maybe you're a student. Maybe you're a high school student, a college student. Maybe your idea of success is being able to graduate with the kind of grades, either to be able to go into the next field, whether that's college or the workforce, but you want to. Success for you is to be able to take that next step, whether it's college or the military or out into the workforce, but you want to be able to land in the career that you want. Maybe success is someday I want to get married and I want to have kids and I want to get old enough to see my kids get married and to have kids. And maybe success for you is just getting up and putting on clothes that aren't wrinkled before your next video call. But what about as a follower of Jesus? What does success look like as a follower of Jesus? Does it mean that you need to read through the entire Bible in your lifetime? Is that success? Is success memorizing the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus' most famous, you know, teaching? If I memorize that, I'll be a success. Maybe it's, well, it's a fast of 40 days and 40 nights. Jesus did it. If I can do that, okay, awesome. Do I have to perform a miracle maybe to be successful? I mean, There are faith traditions that you can't achieve sainthood unless you perform a miracle. So maybe that's success. Success ultimately depends on the mission you have accepted. And so as we continue on in our series, Good News for Everyone, we're going to be in Luke chapter 9. And so if you've got a Bible or the Bible app on our device, you can flip or click or swipe your way over to Luke chapter 9. We're going to start in verse 37 in a couple of minutes. But you need a little bit of background information before we jump into the passage. And the thing that you need to know is that prior to this chapter, or prior to the section that we're going to go through, Jesus and three of his disciples go up on a mountain. So it's Jesus and Peter and James and John, and they go to this mountain, and wild things happen on this mountain. You can go and read that another time, but ultimately on the top of the mountain, there's an affirmation of Jesus's mission. And his mission is ultimately, you know, to save the world from the power of death and sin. But the way that he's going to do that is by his own death and burial, and resurrection. And Jesus is solid when it comes to his mission. He knows what he has to do, and he is going for it. But there are some lessons that his disciples have to learn along the way that they're not quite certain on what their role is in this overall mission. So we're going to pick up the account here in Luke 9, starting in verse 37. The next day, when they came down from the mountain, a large crowd met him. A man in the crowd called out, "Teacher, I beg you to look at my son, for he is my only child." A spirit seizes him, and he suddenly screams. It throws him into convulsions so that he foams at the mouth. It scarcely ever leaves him and is destroying him. "I begged your disciples to drive it out, but they could not." "You unbelieving and perverse generation," Jesus replied, "how long shall I stay with you and put up with you? Bring your son here." Even while the boy was coming, the demon threw him to the ground in a convulsion. But Jesus rebuked the impure spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. And they were all amazed at the greatness of God. So Jesus and his disciples, they come off of this mountain. Peter and James and John come fresh off this experience, and they are met by this massive crowd. And without a doubt, everybody in the crowd wants something from Jesus. And the way that I picture this happening is that there are all these voices calling out, "Jesus, Jesus, I need this. Jesus, can you do that?" And I just picture there's this one voice that kind of rises up all the rest. And it's the voice of a desperate, panicked father because there's nothing he can do to help his only son. His son is being tormented by an evil spirit. Now, this account is actually told in the Gospel of Luke and Matthew and Mark, and they all include some different details. In some of the other Gospels, we see that this spirit is causing the boy to be thrown into fires, that the spirit is causing him to have convulsions, to be foaming at the mouth, and his dad is watching all this, and he's helpless. And so he's crying out to Jesus, "Can you help my son? This thing is literally destroying him. And I asked your disciples, and they couldn't do anything about it." And so where the disciples failed, we see that Jesus is able to not only cast out this evil spirit, but we see that Jesus physically heals this boy before returning him to his father. And as the passage states, and everybody was amazed at what was going on. Now, what we don't read here, but we see in some of the other gospel accounts, is that afterwards, the other nine disciples wonder, like, "Jesus, why? Why couldn't we do it? What was the difference?" When Jesus had called the 12 together, he gave them power and authority to drive out all demons and to cure diseases. So they went out and went from village to village, proclaiming the good news and healing people everywhere. So what happened? Why were the disciples not able to cast out this particular spirit? I mean, we just read that they'd been given the power, they'd been given the authority. Why couldn't they do it? Well, the answers are actually found not in Luke's gospel, but in Matthew and Mark's recollection of this situation. As they ask Jesus why, here's what Jesus says. He says, "It's because you have so little faith." And then in the Gospel of Mark, he also says, you know, this kind can only come out by prayer. And so what we have happening here is that the disciples were attempting to do this work of God without including God in the process. You know, casting out a demon wasn't as simple as just saying the right words and doing a hand motion, kind of like you're a kid at Hogwarts casting a spell. It's not about the technique. It was a matter of seeking God in prayer and seeking His power rather than trying to do it on their own. And sometimes we can stumble like the disciples do, or like the disciples did, because we can experience God's power in our life, but as we continue on our journey, we can forget it's God doing it in the first place. And sometimes maybe we get the confidence of like, oh, look at the things that I did, but it's been God the whole time. And we can sometimes have this attitude of like, I can do it. But it was Jesus who said in the Gospel of John, apart from me, you can do nothing. Success doesn't happen when God sees us doing great things, but when we trust in His power to do great things. But there are more lessons for the disciples to learn, so let's pick up the next lesson, starting in verse 46. An argument started among the disciples as to which of them would be the greatest. Jesus, knowing their thoughts, took a little child and had him stand beside him. And then he said to them, whoever welcomes this little child in my name welcomes me, and whoever welcomes me welcomes the one who sent me. For it is the one who is least among you who is the greatest. Master, said John, we saw someone driving out demons in your name, and we tried to stop him because he's not one of us. Do not stop him, Jesus said, for whoever is not against you is for you. So this passage to me is a little bit silly. We've got this scenario where the disciples are traveling with Jesus and they're literally arguing about who's number one. This is the equivalent as if Tom Brady, 7-time Super Bowl champion, let's just say he quit football this year and he started coaching a high school junior varsity football team. And they're going through the season, the first 4 or 5 games, like they've won some, they lost some, but in their next game, they're just getting crushed. And at halftime, they're all in the locker room and all the players are arguing about who the MVP is when the greatest player of all time is sitting in the room with them. I mean, it's just goofy. And so Jesus kind of sits back and he's like, okay, I need to redefine great for you guys. Now that you're arguing about greatness, let me tell you what great is. And he takes a child, okay? And you have to understand that a child held no social status in the Jewish culture whatsoever. They were nothing in Jewish culture. And Jesus takes this child and he brings him right next to him and says, you see this kid? I want you to treat this child like you'd treat me. And this would absolutely blow the disciples' minds. Because here's Jesus telling them, look, you want to be great? Make yourself nothing. Become nothing. There's the key to greatness. And I think they're so rattled by this that John quickly changes the subject. He says, okay, Jesus, but something you got to know. There's a guy out there. He's casting out evil spirits in your name. And so we need you to stop him because he wouldn't stop for us, but he doesn't have a membership card. He's not one of the 12. So we need you to go out there and stop him. Seriously? I mean, their argument is we aren't able to get this done, so he shouldn't be able to either. I mean, the disciples are actually ratting out somebody else for doing what they couldn't do. I mean, they had just failed in casting out that evil spirit out of the little boy because they didn't have enough faith. And here's another man who's not part of their inner circle, but there's this other guy who's out there casting out demons because he did have the faith in Jesus' name, and they're telling Jesus to stop him? That seems kind of dumb, but I don't want to come off judgmental because I've done the same thing, not with evil spirits, but when I was a youth pastor, you know, I would take students to camp every year. I would go to 2 summer camps, one with middle school and one with high school, and I'd go to all these camps, and all these camps had speakers that they would bring in for the week, and without fail, like the students would always love the speaker, and the speaker would do a great job. And after a few years, I was thinking, man, I would love to do that someday. I'd love to be a camp speaker someday and to take a week and to be able to do that. I would love it. And I would graciously offer my services to various camps. And nothing ever came of it. And after a few years, I started to become bitter. And I would take my students to summer camp and I'd be listening to the speaker and I'd be sitting there going like, what is this guy, what does this gal have that I don't? Like, they haven't even finished Bible school. Like, I've been a youth pastor for all these years. Like, why don't I get my shot? But that was just pride. That was just pride getting in the way of the mission. You know, it didn't matter who the mouthpiece was at camp. All that mattered is that God was glorified, no matter who he was going to be using. Success doesn't come when we're recognized as being number one, but when we give God the glory for how he is working, no matter who he is working through. So the third lesson that Jesus has to teach his disciples in kind of this portion of their journey has to do as they are preparing for Jerusalem. Again, remember that Jerusalem is the end of Jesus's mission. That is where his mission is going to come to completion. So we're now going to pick up this account starting in verse 51. As the time approached for him to be taken up to heaven, Jesus resolutely set out for Jerusalem, and he sent messengers on ahead who went into a Samaritan village to get things ready for him. But the people there did not welcome him because he was heading for Jerusalem. When the disciples James and John saw this, they asked, "Lord, do you want us to call down fire from heaven to destroy them?" But Jesus turned and rebuked them. Then he and his disciples went to another village. So again, we need to be reminded of what Jesus' mission was, and that he was heading to Jerusalem to defeat the power of death and sin for all of humanity. He was going to die in order to save countless lives from hell. But the disciples, and in particular here, James and John, they don't understand the mission quite yet. Even though Jesus has already told them a few times, they don't understand the mission. They still are under the belief that Jesus is going to Jerusalem to begin his reign, that he is going to Jerusalem to overthrow the Roman government and to begin this reign as the Messiah, the Savior of God's chosen people. And maybe James and John, maybe they misinterpreted what Jesus had said earlier, "Whoever is not against you is for you," because clearly in this situation, the Samaritans are against them. Like, they just want to make a stopover as they're going to Jerusalem. The Jews and the Samaritans were enemies. They hated each other. They say, "Nope, you're not stopping here. You're going to Jerusalem. This is not a stop that you can make." Well, to James and John, clearly they are against us. And if they're against us, I think it's smiting time. Let's get our smite on. But Jesus rebukes them. Jesus says, like, "Guys, that's not what I've come here to do." Okay, and he probably even understood their heart behind it, because so often in the Old Testament, like, there was plenty of smiting. Okay, God called his people to wipe out their enemies. And so maybe James and John are just thinking, like, "We're going to do it the way that it's been done before." But Jesus is saying, "No, like, we're going to do it differently here." Okay? It's not about judgment. And maybe he reminded them of what he had said to them earlier. You know, and we talked this a few weeks ago, this idea that we're to love our enemies. We're to be praying for our enemies. We're not supposed to take a flamethrower to our enemies. You know, and sometimes we can struggle with what James and John are struggling with here. This idea that maybe we don't want to smite people, maybe we do. But the idea that there are people out there that they don't believe what we believe. Okay, that they're against what we believe. That they would consider themselves our enemies, and so our reaction can be to rush into judgment. Well, if you believe that, then this is what I think about you, and we want to judge, and we want to become the jury. And yet we read in James 2:13, mercy triumphs over judgment. And that's exactly what Jesus wants for the Samaritans here. And actually, this is what we see take place. Okay, so later on in the book of Acts, in Acts chapter 7, we see that there is this great persecution of the Christians, and it forces them to be driven out into other areas to talk about the good news. And the very first place that we see one of the disciples going and telling people the good news is in Samaria, possibly even in the very village where they rejected to have Jesus come in just for a layover. Success doesn't come when we pronounce God's judgment on those who have done wrong, but when we lovingly extend the mercy that he has shown to us. So we see the disciples making mistake after mistake after mistake. You know, they can't heal this little boy. They can't help he and his father. They're arguing about who's number one in the disciple power rankings. They try to blow up a village. I mean, you could actually say that the disciples were failures at following Jesus. But do you know who didn't call them failures? Jesus. Jesus never called them a failure. Now, how do we know that? Well, the last verse in this passage. Then he and his disciples went to another village. Jesus didn't give up on the disciples when they made mistakes. He took the opportunity to teach them, to correct them, to rebuke them when necessary, and then to continue journeying with them. There wasn't a mistake that they could make where he was just going to say, I'm done with you guys. Like, I'm going to go get some new disciples because you're pretty bad at this. See, Jesus didn't give up on the disciples when they blew it. He invited them to learn and to keep going, to keep walking with Jesus. That's success when we continue to walk with Jesus. Success isn't who dies with the most toys. Success isn't reading the entire Bible in the original language. Success isn't diffusing the bomb with 1 second left on the detonator. The good news is that success is found with every step we take to get closer to Jesus. You see, success is about faithfulness to God. It's not about human-driven results. Because like the disciples, we are going to make mistakes. We're going to make the same mistakes that we've been seeing them make in these passages. There are going to be times when our faith is going to falter, that we're going to spend less time praying to God about what we want to see Him do, and we're just going to try to get things done on our own strength. There are going to be times when pride is going to take over and we're going to kind of think, I'm a pretty big deal, and it's going to rob us of effectiveness. There are going to be times when people are going to do things and our first reaction is going to be to judge them as opposed to showing God's mercy. We're going to make the same mistakes, but Jesus is going to treat us the same as He treated His disciples. He's going to correct us. He's going to teach us. He's going to rebuke us when necessary through His word. But He's going to continue walking with us so that we can live out the mission that He has given to us. The mission as a follower of Christ that we have chosen to accept is to love God with all of our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbor as ourself. So there's a pretty well-known proverb in the Old Testament that goes as follows. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to Him, and He will make your path straight. So we have been called to a life of faithfulness, which means that we are called to submit our will to God, and that we are to obey what He has called us to do if you are a follower. And if we can do that, as we learn to submit our lives, as we learn to obey, the path that God lays out for us is going to become more and more clear. And so we've got a little tool that we want to be able to give to you to be able to kind of help you in this process. And so there's going to be a little card that you can print off at home or at work or wherever. And if you're watching in the Sunday interactive service, our host is going to put it in the chat and there's a link there that you can go to. If you're watching on our YouTube channel, there's going to be a link in the description that you can click on and it'll take you to our website. And if you're watching on our website, you're going to be able to find the link right there on the page where you're watching this message. But on there, there's going to be this card that you can print off. And on the card, it says this: I want to faithfully pursue God in this season of life by. And so we want to encourage you to fill that in and to write down a way that you can faithfully pursue God. Now, I want to first address the people that you're not even sure what it means to pursue God. You're not quite sure, like, I'm not really sure what I believe about God or Jesus or the church or any of that. So what is this idea of pursuing God? And so maybe for you, maybe it's not necessarily answering that question, but maybe for you, it's just writing down this question. What would my life look like if I started defining success the way that I've heard it described today? If I described success as taking my next step with God as opposed to setting all these goals for my life and doing whatever it is that I want to do, what if success was defined differently? And maybe it's even talking to God about that and asking him that question. God, what would my life look like if I lived for you instead of the way that I've been doing it? And you may be surprised how he answers you. Maybe your next step is to read more about the life of Jesus. You know, we've been going through this Gospel of Luke, and maybe you want to go back to the beginning and start reading it or reading one of the other Gospel accounts. As we've seen today, the Gospel accounts, they don't tell the exact same stories and include all the same details. Maybe you want to read through Matthew or Mark or John, and maybe that's your next step. And if you don't have a Bible, Bible app is available. It's totally free. It's called YouVersion, and you can download that totally free. But taking any step is going to be a success. Now, for those of you who are following Jesus, what is your next step to getting closer to Jesus? If you want to faithfully pursue him in this season of life, what is your next step? And some of you, you may already know. There may be something that's just been kind of eating away at you, like, I know I need to do this, and I just haven't done it. And maybe it's, I need to be consistent in reading the Bible. Maybe I need to get a Bible reading plan so that I'm held accountable. Maybe I need to tell somebody else, you know, hey, can you hold me accountable on reading the Bible? Maybe it's going and getting the Bible app and going through a 5-day plan or a 14-day plan or a 30-day plan, but maybe that's your next step, is I'm gonna get closer to God by being consistent in reading his word. Maybe your next step is a step of forgiveness. Maybe there's somebody that has done you wrong and you won't let it go. And you kind of know that it's holding you back in your relationship with God. It was Jesus said, forgive others as you have been forgiven. Maybe it's time to do that. Maybe your next step is filling out the connection card and making that decision, it's time for me to start serving, or it's time for me to get plugged into a community group. Whatever it is, write it down on that card and put it somewhere where you can be reminded so you can faithfully take that next step. Because that next step, if you're willing to take it, is going to be a success as we grow closer to Jesus. And so I want to encourage you to release yourself from a life of trying to do whatever it takes to be successful. And I want you to let go and enjoy the freedom of living a life that comes by faithfulness. Well, hey, thank you so much for being and watching here today. We hope you join us again soon.
Thank you so much for sharing with us today, Mike. We've got some great things going on, and we want to make sure that you're staying in the loop about it all. The best ways to do that is through our All Church emails, by following us on Instagram and Facebook, or check in anytime at rainierview.org. We are so excited to announce that we're hosting our very first ever IF gathering. IF is a conference for women to come together, grow in our faith, and take tangible next steps to becoming fully engaged disciples of Jesus in our communities. It's for women of all walks of life, every age, and every stage. We'll hear from speakers such as Janine Allen, Eugene Cho, Francis Chan, Annie F. Downs, Latasha Morrison, so many others. So join us for this hybrid event. Night one will be in person at the Graham campus beginning at 6:30 p.m. And day two will be in the comfort of your living room or a friend's living room, depending on who's in your germ bubble, beginning in the morning. Sign up today on our website and then join us March 5th and 6th to declare that even if the worst happens, we will not lose hope. We're partnering with Olive Crest to provide Easter baskets for foster families. This is a fun, tangible way for us to meet the felt needs of the foster kids in our community. Enjoy shopping for these families, putting together the baskets, and then dropping them off at either of our physical campuses by Sunday, March 14th. You can get all the details at rainierview.org/events. We're a church that loves to be generous. If you call Rainier View your church home, you can give by simply texting RVCC to 77977 to use our safe and secure online system. You can also give by our website or send in a check. If you're joining us for the first time today, please don't feel obligated in any way to give. We're just so glad that you're here. We'll be together for one last song today. During this song, we encourage you to take communion in your homes. This is a time we take every week to think about all that Christ did for us on the cross. So gather some bread and juice and take these reminders of Jesus' body and blood. Thank you again for joining us this morning, and we hope you'll join us again next Sunday right here or at one of our other campuses.
Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Now indeed I find thy power, and thine alone can change the leper's spots and melt the heart of stone. 'Cause Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. And when before the throne I stand in him complete, Jesus died my soul to save. My lips shall still repeat. Jesus paid it all. Oh, to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. Oh, praise the one who paid my debt and raised this life up from the dead. And Jesus paid it all, all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow.